your fullness have we all received. We are free because you made it. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. God is good. Come on. Praise the Lord. Let's just give him praise. Give him praise, everybody. Thank you all. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 Power and might be unto the Lord. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Erabokos mandala demos mandale momoro babesma. Yibakos mendeli amadebos ebrabake demosa. Yema mesmos mavande mesmemos miga mesmemos. Yema mesmemos rabeska mamande. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. I want to tell us something real quick, and then we're going to read maybe a verse of scripture. Who knows? As I was coming up here, am I loud enough? Is it just me? I can't seem to hear myself. Can you hear me good? Okay. Is there a way I can hear me a bit more? If there's a chance that could happen, that'd be awesome. Or by the time you guys are done, I'll hear me more. All right. It's good. Alrighty. God is good. So, as I was coming up here, oh, that sounds better. Praise God. I remember, let me say the way it really happened. I was reminded of something that Jacob said. Jacob said, the Lord was here and I knew it not. And that was the experience of Jacob. But then as I was being brought up here, the one who received me said to me, he said, some are here and they know it not. Now, let me say that again. As soon as he said it, I knew exactly what he just said. You know, some of us are in the presence of God and we know it not. There are two different things, but very typical scenarios. Jacob was where God was, because God came there and he did not recognize it. Whereas some of us, we come to where God is and we don't recognize where we're at. It's like being thirsty and coming to the stream and not knowing that you are at the stream. It is possible to be in the land of plenty and still be in penury. It is possible to come to the abundance that Jesus himself became to us and still be void and without form. And so I know that quite often the reason why that happens to many of us is because we cannot see, or we don't see. So I want to explain a couple of things, and then we're just going to dive right into it. And so there might not be a scripture reading, so that might be it. If you guys are ready to transition, you can. But I was here, and I don't think it's fair for me to keep some of these experiences to myself. Because I was here and I knew where I was, the things that I saw, the things that transpired. And it just occurred to me that there is more room where I was than there were people. But then it also occurs to me while I was there that where I was is where many want to be. So how do you reconcile that? I know that several people want to be here. I am here, and I'm looking around a few joyful people drunk in the Holy Spirit, and yet there was still room. The way to reconcile that is this, very simple. We have desires, but we are not making moves. We have asked for things, but we are not pressing in. We have seen visions, but we are not taking actions. I know that many of us, because this is the more natural thing to do, a more natural inclination is for us to be more conscious of that which is physical, that which is natural, and that which is mostly agreed upon. But like I said, and my wife's called me out a number of times on this, but I keep saying it, that God is not in the consensus of opinion. So what is most agreed upon has become the reality that many of us choose again and again. You know, you ask people, and they can't tell you when they adopted that notion. It's something that most of us grew up in. We grew up in this, with this mindset, in this notion that it is only safe when the community says it is. You want to buy a house? And it's like, are people buying houses now? Is it a safe time to buy a house? And since you were a little kid, you can't tell when you started thinking like that. You understand what I mean? You move into a new neighborhood. And it's like, man, I looked up that school. The ratings are good. But are people going there? Do you know anybody whose kid is there? Nobody wants to be the experiment. Nobody wants to go where others haven't been. You don't want to be the guy to find out. You understand what I mean? And I personally cannot tell you when I started thinking like that, but most of us, we think like that, but it is the opposite of where to find God. So we always want to be where other people are at. Do you know that sometimes we even bring that to the atmosphere of God's presence, wherein you're worshiping, and then you open your eyes to see what other people are doing. Are people getting slain in the spirit? Am I missing out on anything? Is anybody on their faces just yet? Are they kneeling down? Are they raising their hands? What are they doing? You understand what I mean? And that's just because as human beings, we need to feel safe. And we have adopted the presence of other people to be a substitute or to take the place of the presence of God. And you know that I've told you before that the reason why we are naturally like that is because man was made in the image and in the likeness of God. So you need to always have the presence of God. But rather than finding the manifest presence of God, we become satisfied with the many presences of God that other people represent. For those who have not heard me talk about this before, I'm going to just give you a quick illustration because I want you to get it. I'll do it for Z's sake because I know you weren't here when I taught this. There was a time that the Lord was calling me to consecrate myself, but I was a social butterfly. I was the life of the party amongst my mates. This was my second year at the university. You know, I got invited to every party, every hangout. You know, everybody wanted me to go with them to lunch. They wanted me to come back for dinner. You know, I was the guy, you know. And I was also very sensitive at the time to substances. So even if I drank Coca-Cola, I got high, which meant my jokes were never ending, you know. And by then, I was still kind of like running from God. So, you know, my jokes have become so spiritual these days that not everybody gets them. But then I was still very joke relevant, if that makes any sense. You know, everywhere that I went to, I was supposed to be funny. You know what I mean? And that was me. I would hang out. I would go everywhere. And but after a while, I started to sense someone was waiting for me at home. I didn't live on campus anymore after a while. And so suddenly, I would just get up and tell folks, I'll be right back. I need to quickly get home. I'll get on the bus or take a cab and go home. And I'll get home and I'm like, what is this feeling? Why did I think someone was waiting here? And then I'll just chill. And then after a while, I started noticing some strange things. Like I would be by myself and I'll start giggling. And one day I was like, okay, I need to make sense of this. What is really going on? And the Holy Spirit said to me that it was him. I was like, now that makes sense. The feeling. And I said, okay, I like that. Just let me know. Like you want to hang out and I will come. But I was still spending a lot of time with my friends. And one day I asked him, I said, why do I struggle sometimes to come here? And he said to me, he said, because you find the company of your friends worthy of your presence. And I'm like, yeah, but they're not you. I mean, they're fun. It's nice to hang out, but I get more out of being here with you. And he said to me, he said, but you need to know that they are like me. They are made in my image and in my likeness. And the Holy Spirit broke it down to me that if we're not intentional about choosing God, we will stop at men. And so I had to make that conscious decision to recognize the place of man in my life and not let it take the place of God. You see, man was made in the image and in the likeness of God. So it's not like trying to put a round peg in a square hole. It is square to square, round or sphere to circle. It matches perfectly, but the quality is not the same because we're talking about the fact that no one of us is the totality of God, but each one of us is a unique individual expression of God. I like the way that a man put it many years ago in a book that I read. He said, God made man in a bid to express his individuality. God is the totality of all things. So you can't catch God in a particular personality and say that is God. But every little personality that you see being expressed, that is God's individuality expressed in various forms. And that is why as long as the earth remains, we can keep having children and they will come with their own personalities. Every soul is unique because each one of us has an opportunity to reflect an instance of the totality of all things, which is called God. And so in order for us to be able to see what God looks like, then you would have to find a way to generate all possible instances of the human soul and put them together at the same time. Because without a concatenation of our individualities, there is no consolidation of God's totality. And what that means is as much as we can enjoy the presence of other people. Let me give you some more practical examples. You know, sometimes when you're feeling sad or something terrible or what you would consider terrible has just happened, sometimes you just want somebody to sit with you. You just want somebody to hold. You just feel bad at the moment you know that there is somebody else. But before that person came, the one that is omnipresent was there. You understand what I mean? But then as soon as a human being comes, now you suddenly feel like, oh, thank God you're here. Okay, what about the God who's been there the entire time, who never left? You understand what I mean? And God understands because he knows that in the dimension that we're in, certain things just appear to be more real to us just because of the fact that we have chosen to magnify the outward existence over the inward essence. And so I started to learn from that moment that, okay, wait a minute. The reason why I like being with people is because I can talk to them, they can talk to me. You don't want to hang out with people that you talk to who don't talk back to you. You understand what I mean? And people don't want to hang out with you if they're talking to you and you're not talking to them. You might as well just go home. You know, we used to send people away from gatherings like, dude, if you don't want to be here, just go home. We're here to have fun. We're not here to discuss the math project. You know what I mean? So take your geeky surf out of here. Because that's not what this is about. You know? And so, you know, and some people are party poopers. We all knew that we had just failed the test. And we just want to just forget about it for a moment. And then someone keeps bringing it back. And I'm like, that's the last thing I want to hear right now. Let the dead bury the dead. As for us, we will have fun. You understand what I mean? And so, let's bring the party here. I have come to recognize one thing, that we only experience God to the tune of our knowledge of Him. You understand what I mean? And so, when I say that God is not in the consensus of opinion, it's because He's a jealous God and He likes for you to see Him very distinct from everybody else or anything else that may look like Him. God is taking you on a journey, but you're so used to having people around you that God would have to separate you from people for a season so that you can have a clearer picture of who God is. Because as long as people are still taking the place of God in your life, you will have a sense of security and a sense of safety that may not be exactly what you need in totality. I'll give you one more example because I want us to be able to get this thing very clearly as it holds the key to the times that we're in. You know, I had a chance to chat with Shayla a little bit earlier and we were talking about the fact that the season that we're in, this dispensation, this particular dispensation, is a test. Everything is a test. You are being tested. And that is the reason why, just as we were saying, you know, myself, Ryan, and Olivia, that it's like, we are the righteous. How come sometimes it feels like we can't even catch a wink? Whereas the Bible says there's no rest for the wicked. And it's like, but these days, even the righteous can hardly get sleep. You understand what I mean? And now, the reality of it is, we are being tested. And if you don't recognize that you have been tested, two things can happen. You can fail the test, or you can be overwhelmed by the test. The people who don't know that it's a test get overwhelmed. They just feel like, wow, why are these things happening? No, it's not like the devil is coming for you and you alone. Like you have an old quarrel to settle. No, the dude, let's be clear here, the team, because we often tend to think about one person being the one going around. Jesus did say that your adversary, the devil, yes, we know that, but we also know that there are other forces, principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world. So you can think about it as, you know, team D and team L, team darkness and team light. So there's a bunch of folks who are working together just to make sure that you are thoroughly tested. That is their assignment. And some of them are pretty good at it. They test you so much, sometimes you cry. And your father is like, come on, it's just a test. I paid for this. You understand what I mean? It's like when your parents pay to send you to school, they pay to send you to be tested. And then you would cry, you would get angry, you would even come home and be reporting people to your parents that they paid for to make your life miserable. You understand what I mean? And it is something that we need to understand. We need to begin to recognize these things for what they are. You understand what I mean? Because it takes a lot to set up this classroom, this stage that is called the world right now. It takes a lot. God's put a lot into it. Do you know that God has to put up with certain forces just for your sake? You understand what I mean? You know, because God is happy having the devil in the bottomless pit, just falling freely forever, not bothering anybody. But then, how are you going to become strong? Do you understand what I mean? And so God has to put up with Satan. And you know, Satan, you know, when God has meetings, he shows up. You see, Job chapter 1, the Bible says there was a meeting of the sons of God wherein they had come to give an account of their activities. And Satan too showed up because it's like, man, the last time I checked, I am still a spirit. And the Bible says God is the father of all spirits. And so when he's having a meeting of his sons, you better invite me because I'm coming. And the Bible says that he was there and he was even giving audience. God gave him some attention. He was like, okay, your turn. What have you been up to? So when you think about all of what God has to put up, because when you look at the New Jerusalem, wherein we will be for all eternity. When I say where we're going to be for all eternity, that is going to be our abode. But there will be other dimensions and other regions where we get to go and do business and return home. Okay? So don't just think about it, because I know many people have looked into the new heavenly Jerusalem, particularly the description of it being a perfect cube. And it's only about what? Maybe like about 400 meters across or miles. And people are like, yeah, that's not a big space. Come on. I mean, look at how big the earth is right now, and we know that there are other places. Why confine us to that place? No, the Bible never said that we're going to be confined. The Bible says that we will be resident there, but they will be going out and they will be coming in. We will go to other places. You're just advised not to bring back things that are not worthy of his face. You understand what I mean? Revelations 22. You can't bring back things that are not worthy of the face of the Lord Jesus, because it will be the light in the midst of her. But to go back to the very fundamental reason why that building or that city exists is it's going to be our residence. And when you think about what God envisions to be the perfect picture of where he wants to spend eternity with his children, because God the Father will be there and the Lord Jesus is going to be there as well, right? And so, what is God's perfect picture of the future, of eternity? No Satan, no evil, no fears. He says, I will wipe away all their tears, and they will have no retention of their pain. So we will not be able to retain any painful memory of this school that we're in. All the scars will be done away with. But we will keep the lessons that we have learned, because if we don't retain the lessons, everything would be a waste, okay? Because we're learning here to adopt the value system to be able to function in the new heavenly Jerusalem, all right? And so when you think about all of what God is putting up with now, because he's preparing us for the place that he's preparing for us, then we need to start to appreciate it and stop crying and stop reporting people to God. He paid for those people to come and do time in your life. All those people that come to test you and to annoy you, they are part of the stage that God himself has carefully simulated by the instrumentation of his word. So it is not the end of your world. Whatever it is that you're going through. Whatever it is that you're going through was not designed to be the end of you. Everything that we'll go through, that is the reason why the Bible says that we need to rejoice in tribulations, because the trying of our faith works within us patience and ultimately godliness. Why? Because only godly people will be in the new heavenly Jerusalem, and the process of creating gold out of dust is what you're currently experiencing. The fires that we're going through, the pressures that we're experiencing, is the only process known for creating something precious out of that which is common. Does it make sense? And so you need to be able to take a step backwards. You know, the Holy Spirit got me focusing on these things in the last 2 days, because on Saturday I was here and I was excited about the name Solomon and what it means to be peaceful, how when you're peaceful, you give birth to Rehoboam, the confidence that God is the one that enlarges you, and how your confidence in God, coupled with the knowledge of him that you have, that he is your Abijah, which is, what does it mean? That God, Jehovah, is your father, is what ultimately consolidated will result in the healing of your soul, right? And that was pretty exciting. I think it was some, good concept that we got reminded of and got taught on Saturday. But I kept pressing in, and I knew the Holy Spirit was drawing me closer to examine even further how to truly be at peace. And the reason why many of us are not at peace is because of the fact that we do not know where we're at. We don't know the difference between the classroom and the house. When we come to the presence of God, that is you leaving the class and the school behind to go home. Every kid gets to go home at the end of the day. Right? And so when I came up here, and the one who received me up here And when I say the one who received me up here, if you're watching online and you're like, I saw when they brought you up, there was nobody here. Well, I'm talking about the one in the spirit, the angel of the Lord that received me up here. He said that to me, that many people are with God and they do not know it. We've analyzed Jacob, but we have not analyzed ourselves. We talk about Jacob, whose presence of God visited, but only recognized it after he woke up and was like, oops, the Lord was here and I knew it not. But what about you who are here, who still do not know where you're at? When you come to the presence of God, when you see two or three people gathered in his name, he is there. And where God is home. And so when you're home, you get to rest from all the trouble of the school, all the tests of the classrooms, all the pain, whatever it is, you need to learn how to just breathe and say, now I'm home, I can get cleaned, I can get fed, I can get, you know, I can get some help for my homework, I can get revitalized to go back to school another day. Praise the Lord. And so, let's continue to bring the parables together. Many of us are like children who go to school and don't go home at the end of the day. If you stay at school for a whole week without going home, you're not going to have any friends because you'll be so smelly. You're not going to have any friends because people will avoid you because you're always begging for things. You're begging for them to give you a word that will comfort you. You're begging for their snack. You're begging for things that are at home, but you didn't go home. That's why you don't have those things. You understand what I mean? And so we put burdens on people and on the system that is not designed to cater to you after 3 o'clock or whatever your school closure time is. You see, many of us come into the presence of God like a child who truly gets on the bus. Goes home, but stays at the bus stop until the next day. You don't press in. Until you come in through that driveway and open the door and get received in the embrace of your mother, which is preferred to that of the daddy. But if we're available, we can make it happen too. You know, I don't know what y'all experience in your homes, but my kids, when they come from school and I'm the one who receives them, they will hug me. How was your day? Oh, it was fine. And then the next thing, their mom comes downstairs and then they pretend like they just got there. So I'm like, so what was all that stuff? Y'all just did that so I don't feel bad. You know, sometimes it's like if they haven't received that hug, mine is just kind of like, I don't know. Yeah, but it is what it is. I think I've come to accept it. You know, there's nothing like a mother's love. You know, in fact, do you know that who were we talking about? I think on Saturday, we're talking about the meaning of El Shaddai. You know, because that's one time that we actually like to see God as a mother. Because the word El Shaddai means the big-breasted one. And that is why, you know, when you need comfort, you want to go to God as the El Shaddai because his embrace will comfort you. You don't want to go to him as a man of war when you need comfort because you're just going to be like muscle to muscle. Nothing's going to happen. Anyway, just trying to justify the reason why mothers get that privilege. But when you go home and you stay at the bus stop until the next day, you're most likely going to be you will be more tired, you will be hungry, and you will go back to school looking unkempt. Life is a school where we get tested, where we get drilled, where we learn. But when we come to the presence of our Heavenly Father, we are home and we need to allow ourselves to be ministered to. Many of us, the angels recognize when we come into God's presence and they're ready to bring your replenishment kit. But before they turn around, you're gone. You're still standing there, but you've separated what they need to minister to from the dimension where they are available. Let me explain. I can be standing here, but as long as I don't see that angel physically standing there with me in flesh and blood, whatever they want to do, they can only do in the dimension wherein they are present. That means in the spirit. But if I'm here and my spirit is not coming in because of guilt, if my spirit is not pressing in because of unbelief, if my spirit is not pressing in because of lack of trust, if I don't trust that God's got me covered, then what happens is I am physically here, but my mind is still playing God outside in my thoughts trying to solve all of my problems. We need to learn how to lay down when we come into the presence of God. I look forward to coming here. I am always so eager because I know that all of what I need for the next assignments to come, and even maybe for some that I left unfinished before I left home, the resources are here. Why? Because the one who sent me out there is in here. And God is the one that is most concerned about my success. I'm his project. I didn't invent myself. I am not my own investment. My money that is in the bank is not trying to multiply itself just because it feels under pressure. You know, just imagine if your money in the bank is like, oh my God, they've put me in this bank for like 2 months and I haven't even gained any interest. Maybe I need to call the FDIC. Maybe I need to see who needs a loan. Your money doesn't have to do that because it is not its own investment. You are the one thinking of how to multiply your seed sown. Anyway, God is the one who multiplies seed sown, but you get what I mean. When it comes to your money, you are the one who's somewhat responsible for that investment. You see, because it's been committed to you. And that is the way you and I are in the hand of God. You see, if we're going to be at peace, we need to recognize that this is nothing but a school. It looks very real. It feels very real. But it is nothing but a school to bring out the best in me. So why do I need to cry and get frustrated and feel hopeless? The one who sent me here knew this is the right school for me. I attend the classes that are designed specifically to impart things into me. And so I should quit complaining about that math class, about that geography class. I need to just rejoice and be glad because my Father loves me so much. If he says I need to be here, then there's something in here for me that is special, that is gold. It changes your attitude toward life and allows for you to enjoy that which your Father has paid for. You see what I'm saying? So let me go back to this horse. I thought it was dead, but no, we need to beat it some more. This concept of being in God's presence and not knowing where you're at. You see, when you come in here, you need to consciously check out of the flesh. You need to be intentional about checking out of your conscious thoughts. Because if you don't do it intentionally, and it has to be done for you, it's not always as pleasant. Right? Imagine when you're trying to undress a child. They even then know how to raise their hands. But some of us, the angels want to take off the dirty clothes so that they can wash us and put new ones on us, but we're not raising our hands. You understand what I mean? It's like someone is trying to pull your shirt and you have your hands down. It will be a thug of war. It's going to be a struggle because you're supposed to raise your hand. You see, raising your hand is a sign of surrender, letting another minister to you. And someone says, well, but if I raise my hand in the physical, how does that equate to what you were saying about the dimension where the angels are operating? The Bible says from the visible elements, we have an understanding of the invisible. That which is seen is the manifestation of that which is unseen. When you raise your hand like that, it helps the picture that you are creating or that you're running in your mind to come into resonance so that your inward reality can be better managed. You understand what I mean? If I say that, oh Lord, I surrender to you, but I'm not saying it and I'm not making the right gestures, it's difficult for me to sustain the thought long enough for it to become a reality. You see, many of us, we think our imagination is only for solving problems at work. Your imagination, all of your faculties and resources within are supposed to be brought to the table in your dealings with God. So when you come in here, you see, some people think the power would have to just hit them, boom, somehow, and then they'll be on their faces. No, if that's the way God's been whacking people and knocking people out, nobody would want to deal with him but Moses and Joshua. Because God tried that before. It's not like he didn't try it. He tried it for your sake. Of course, he knew that it wasn't going to work, right? He was already talking to Moses. But the children of Israel were like, what makes you feel so special? Sometimes Moses would come to them from God and says, this is what God is saying. Guys, let's get excited. Let's do this. And they're like, how come God is always talking to only you? In fact, we're not doing it because he hasn't spoken to us. Remember that was what happened. They started becoming more reluctant to follow the word of the Lord in the mouth of Moses because God wasn't speaking to them directly. So they were like, maybe if that God is really serious about leading us through the wilderness, he will come talk to us directly. We're going home. And that was what they did. And God was like, okay, I'll come. And when he showed up, they're like, keep talking to Moses. Because they just weren't ready for him. You see what I mean? And the thing is, if God was so kind to demonstrate that to us, why should we expect that something that was shown to not work will still be worked, will still be repeated by heaven? God is not a man. We're the ones who do things like that. You know, that's why some of us, we date the same kind of people 6 times before we learn our lessons. You know, so much stress later, you know, and you could have avoided it after the first person. When the second person comes along, you're like, hey, I've seen this before. Moving on. But we're like, maybe he's different because that other one was an Adidas guy, but he's a Nike guy. You understand what I mean? Maybe there's a little difference. That other one used to drive a beat-up Nissan, but this one's got a Mercedes, and it's actually an E-Class. Maybe it's different. No. All the outward appearances, the Bible did not say test the designer wears. It says test all spirits. And you will know that which is of God, but we'll be testing all the flimsy things that God does not even see. If your heavenly Father does not look at the appearance, what is your problem? You understand what I mean? Because, you know, especially guys, you know, you find a lot of guys, they keep going after the same kind of woman because of the outward appearance, you know, but God's not looking at that. He's looking at the heart. Because that outward appearance, the one who made it knows that it is only temporal. The Bible says that beauty is deceitful and charm is vain. The word vain there is the word passing. When the Bible says that charm is passing, you know, you can be enraptured by someone's outward appearance and their charm, but after a while, it fades away. You understand what I mean? That which remains forever is the unseen. The Bible says the things that are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are what? Are eternal. When I started dating my wife, I had no hair on my head. I was like Chris almost. I would shave everything off because I just wasn't interested in having any hairs, and I had become so buried in my work. I had become so geeky. Everything about me had to be about making progress and being productive. And you see all that outward appearance of no hair, I would shave everything. Sometimes I looked like, let's not even go there, but now I have hair and a little bit more than Alan even. So imagine if my wife was stuck on the outward appearance, we wouldn't have made any progress. But that which she saw that the Lord pointed out to her is still here today, which is the hunger and the thirst for the righteousness of the kingdom. And every single one of us, we have those treasures. The Bible says we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Every single one of us, we have the treasure, which is the unseen, but we keep getting stuck in the seen. You see, what you can see is that bank statement and what it says you have. But that is not what this statement says. This statement says that you have all things and you are bound unto every good work. Praise the Lord. So going back, and hopefully this is the final whip and the horse will be dead. When you come into the presence of God, follow the examples that are recommended in Scripture. Throw yourself into that presence joyfully. David says, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful that you are here. Because if you truly believe that everything you need is in that presence, wouldn't you be glad when you are there? I mean, a week ago, I said to us that if someone laid out $1 million on this stage, okay, let's make it 7 million because Laura is here, because to her, 1 million might be nothing. But let's say somebody has $7 million on the stage here. When you come in and they say that everything that is on that stage is yours, Imagine when you come in, you're not going to come in and still be worrying about your $30 phone bill that is not paid. There is $7 million here. You understand what I mean? I will be very happy. I'll be waiting for the bell, for the ribbon to drop, for them to say, it's go time. You see what I mean? And so when we come into the presence of God and we're not delighted and we're not glad, we're already limiting our own access. You're telling yourself you would only wait behind the gate while other people press in. Right? So let me tell you one more reason why I'm saying all of these things today. The Lord's been showing me and a group of others here and several others, I would say, that let me even ask by show of hands, how many people have had dreams lately of warfare? Dreams wherein you've had to fight someone or something. You see what I mean? That's a good number of us, okay? And that's because the opposition is at an all-time high, okay? Now, if we are going to be prepared to overcome while not losing our peace and joy, then we need all the equipping that we can get. We need all the love and support that we can get, right? And so it's become more important for us than ever before to ensure that we are always in the presence of God. You need to make it home every day, because that is the nature of the times that we're in. Now, when we come here with the mindset that everything we need is here, how do we let heaven know our mindset? You see, because what do we say? We say that a child with raised arms gets picked up. So if you're not showing, your faith has to be demonstrated by your works. Let's go back to the Jacob example. He said, the Lord was here and I knew it not. But now that I know, I will do something about it. He didn't just walk away. The Bible said he set up a pillar and he anointed it. He was like, since I now know that the Lord is here, I need to do something to rectify the ignorance. The Bible says buying up the times for the days are evil. So how do I buy up the time? By faith, because with our works coupled with my faith, I have no faith. So if I truly believe that God is where he says he would be, which is wherever two or three are gathered, the moment I come in here and it's not just me in the lobby, I'm already working on my heart. I'm already telling myself it's time to get in. Let me tell you the way that I see myself when I come in here. I think I've shared it with some of y'all before. When I come in here and fellowship begins in the lobby out there, I start taking off my shirt. I don't physically take off my shirt, but in the spirit, I'm undressing for the pool. Because I don't want to wait until they open the doors and say, well, the pool is not open, before I start, you know, taking off my shoes and my socks and doing the pre-shower. No, I do all of that and I'm getting ready. I am eager. The moment the doors open, boom, I'm in the water. Because after a while, we got to go back to where we came from. You understand what I mean? There is a measure of God's presence with me at home. There is a measure of God's presence with you in your car. But this particular one is the recommended presence of God for the last days. The Bible says in Hebrews 10:25, do not forsake the gathering together of yourselves, especially as you see the day approaching. And so this one that is recommended, oh my goodness. You can take the other ones as supplements. This is the main course. This is the main meal right here. So what do? We get ready to throw ourselves into it. I am begging you folks, because in recent times, there's not really been a service that we come to that I don't get to see myself visibly in the realm of the spirit, having interactions with angels, getting ministered to by the Lord. And it's showing. It shows in my work. It shows in my business dealings. It shows in my dealings with my children, with my wife. It shows even in my quiet time when I'm at home, when I'm studying scriptures. There are times when I just have an understanding that gets downloaded to me, and I can trace it back to the last time I was here.
And so I want to encourage you, let's not miss out, because it takes a lot to set this up. You understand what I mean? It takes a lot, even for you to get here. Someone's driven an hour to be here. It takes a lot to get in here. It takes a lot, even though we complain that it gets too cold, but we pay to cool the place down. You understand what I mean? Everything costs something because of the fact that God wants us to see, just by the little that we get to spend, how much He gets to spend for us to have this collective experience of human existence, so that by the time we become transhuman, we are full of gratitude. And we will be transhuman, because the Bible says that we're going to put away mortality and take on immortality. You see, everything that we're going to be, the world is trying to overtake us. They're trying to say that they're, you know, all that stuff. It is for us. Okay? Now, let's read one verse of scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. And so let's start getting ready to break bread. And I'm going to visit one of the other parables that I mentioned that I haven't explained. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. So, I already explained the parable of being with my friends and how sometimes talking to people, we kind of get satisfied with talking to people when we haven't even talked to God, right? So I want to give us another example. Many times when we have issues, we're always looking for somebody to talk to. I want you to make it a habit, if you haven't, to always ask yourself, I just spoke to my wife about this thing, but have I spoken to Jesus about it? I just spoke to my client about this thing, but have I spoken to God about it? I've been talking to myself in the mirror about this thing, but have I spoken to God about it? We need to make it a habit to ensure that we do not just get satisfied with what people can do in our lives. We always reserve a place for God at all times. In conversations, in interactions, in getting counsel, in sharing the joy of your day with somebody. Also share it with God. He wants to know. He's the number one stakeholder in your existence. The Bible says we are the planting of the Lord, that He may be glorified. We've been reading a lot lately from Jeremiah chapter, is it Jeremiah 11, 7? We've been reading, talking about the fact that God says, I planted you, but you keep burning incense to Baal. Don't complain to the system. You know, some of us, the reason why we yell on the phone to T-Mobile is because we think that they're responsible for your happiness. No. Before you yell, sometimes talk to God about it and say, God, what's really going on? In fact, let me give you one quick example, a testimony even. There was a time I was doing some work for the British government. I was a field engineer, and they paid me to travel everywhere they sent me, but they never paid for my tickets. So if I was driving and I got a speeding ticket, I paid for it, even though I was driving to go do their job. That one, I can see how that is my problem. But the one that I struggled with was whenever I was in central London at ungodly hours, hours that I wasn't planning to be there, but the project ran over. If I drove in zone one, because they have different zones, and if you haven't prepaid to drive in that zone, you pay the penalty. Right? So after a while, I'm like, I should be able to just send these people because I was doing their job. But no, they only want to pay for your travel time and pay for your gas. But all the infringements, those ones are on you. And so one day I was lamenting. I was really frustrated. In 1 week, I had, I think, about 290 pounds of penalties. Ridiculous. In fact, in one day, out of the total sum, one day was just 150 pounds because I went in this way. I got lost. I went out that way. I got lost. Not funny, but I went back this way. Yeah, my wife is laughing because she knows. I used to have a GPS at the time that was called Road Angel. No, the people didn't have Road Angel here. They had Garmin here. All right? Yeah, same people, different name. But you see that Road Angel, after a while, one day out of frustration, I was talking to my wife. I said, this thing is a road demon. Because it kept getting me lost everywhere. And so I was there. I was really angry and lamenting. But there was nobody that I could talk to. You know how it is? If you're doing work for individuals, you can complain to them. But when you're doing government work, who do you want to yell to? I couldn't yell at anybody. So I was standing there and I was just like, God, why is this happening? And he said to me, he said, that's because you're not looking up high enough. I said, okay, how does that work? He said, are they above you or am I above you? I said, well, you are above me. He said, so this assignment, primarily, who sent you? I was like, you sent me. He said, okay. You don't like the way they manage things. Are you complaining about how I manage things too? I said, no. He said, okay, so if I send you and you incur any cost along the way, the me that you know, will I force you to pay or will I pay? I said, Father, you will pay because that's what you do. God sent man to the garden, and when they sinned, he was the one who paid for it. Right? Even before the final invoice was out, he made a temporary deposit. He killed the animal, gave them the skin of the animal to put on. And God was like, you keep thinking too much about the world system and how much of your life is in their hands, whereas it is in mine. He says, quit worrying about the bills. He said, let me take care of that. You just take care of me. The Lord says, keep doing what you do. Put on that smile while you're there. Help the people who haven't asked for it. Because a lot of the times why that I would be on the road at ungodly hours was because I would stay back to teach people. I would stay back to help other engineers do their work. And I became so popular on the project because people kept requesting for me to be on their project. And so God says, keep doing what you do. Take care of me and I will take care of you. Do you know what happened after that conversation that we had? They sent me an email, and the email that they sent me included every expense, but they didn't say they were paying for my expenses. They said that I had some travel time that was not claimed. So in 1 week, they paid me for about 84 hours. When I told my sister, she was like, that's not even fair. I said, that's what I thought, but it has another name. It's called grace. You understand what I mean? So we need to know who we are. We need to know whose we are. So I want to encourage you. The person who sent you out there knows someone's going to break your heart. The person who sent you out there knows a business partner will attempt to cheat you. The person who sent you out there already knew that some crazy driver will cut in front of you, but he still wants you to glorify him. And you will only be able to do that if you are at peace all the time. And your peace hinges on you knowing who sent you out there and also knowing when to come back into the fold. You are his sheep and he is the shepherd. You don't have to keep trying to fend for yourself. Learn to come back home and let the good shepherd take out the ticks that are sucking your blood. Learn to come back and let the good shepherd shave off the excess hair that is growing around your face, obstructing your view of your surroundings. Learn to come into his presence and say, I am here, fill me. On Saturday, I told you that if Jesus needed to be ministered to by the angels, you and I need more help. Because we do get into more trouble than he ever did. You understand what I mean? Because he didn't create trouble for himself. Other people created trouble for him. But you and I are skilled at playing both ends. We can play both sides. I can create trouble for myself, you know. And then other people too can do the same. And so I need more of that ministry than he did. But he needed the angels as a demonstration to me of my dependence on heaven. So 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. What does it say? It says now, I'll wait for you to get there if you're reading along. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. It says now we have not received the spirit of the world. That means there is a spirit that is the spirit of the world, right? But the spirit who is from God, that we may know the things that have been freely given to us by God. We're going to break bread and wrap up on this note. Let's read again. One more time. Now we have received not the spirit of this world, but the spirit who is from God, that we may know the things that have been freely given to us by God. The Bible says these things, verse 13, we also speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Folks, there is a spirit that we have received that is not the spirit of the world. It is by coming into that realization that we are able to enjoy, the Bible says, all the things that have been freely given to us. So if I am not aware of the fact that I have an advantage that the world does not have, then I am automatically at a disadvantage. Right? Because if I am not using what the world is using to help them get by, and I come to church and I'm not able to fully press in, then I am at a loss. Does it make sense? Because some people are out there figuring how to help themselves. That is the spirit of the world. But you have the spirit of God. So don't just say, I have the Spirit of God, without pressing into the fullness of what the Spirit can get you. So when I'm here, I should be accelerated ahead of my mates who are not here. Like David said, the Lord has anointed me with the oil of gladness above my fellows. This presence of God's situation is an undue. It's an unusual advantage. And so I want to encourage you. Now let me tell you what I saw. I'm going to tell you a little bit of it. I was in a place, and I found myself in a silo, a beautiful silo. This silo is a silo that could have been made only by God alone. I mean, I could tell from the walls, from the way that it was fabricated and put together, I knew this was a heavenly silo. And it was full of grains, and the grains were golden. And I was there, and it covered me. I had to bring out my neck from inside the plenty. You know, when you're talking about abundance, that was what I saw. I saw that and a few people, but I knew that there were more people outside asking for the same, but they were not in. And it's not a place you climb to, it's a place that you dive into. And so they were there, standing along the edge, and all they needed to do was just to dive into the plenty. And while I was there, I heard one that said with a loud voice, like a singing voice, like if someone was singing. And the announcement that that singing voice was making was, you have not just grains, but you have the daily edibles too. And I saw a rain of fresh vegetables that were coming down. And the Lord said to me, he says, the things that I have for you are the things that will prosper you for generations. He said, but then at the same time, I will keep bringing you the vegetables. There will be opportunities for you to have something fresh every day. I stood there and I'm like, wow. A thought came to my mind in that moment. And this is the thought, just for stopping by. Because I would take this, what? Well, how long were we there praying? Maybe like 30 minutes having worship. That is like stopping by. That is not even like saying, no, I'm actually being in my Father's presence. Being in God's presence, it's something that we should do for hours at a stretch. So that one was for stopping by. I said, for stopping by, Lord, you have opened my eyes to see your glory. Now, someone is like, but you saw provision. How is that glory? Oh, Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. It says, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. The glory of God is abundance. The glory of God is a manifestation of the faithfulness of God. So why am I saying all of that? I say all of that to you because I don't even think we had started singing when I saw that. When you come in and you know where you're at, you will dive in, and when you dive in, you will be replenished, you will be refreshed. And so today, as we break bread, I want to pray very quickly. I'm cutting the sermon short so that I can pray for people. I know there are tired people in here. You're tired of how things are in the world. You're tired of how things are in your life. You're tired of being where you're at. You've been where you're at now for a while and you're like, okay, that's it. I'm just tired. I want to pray for you. So as we break bread, I want you to come with your cup if you would like for me to pray for you, because by the laying on of hands, the Bible says that we stir up the gift. By the laying on of hands of the eldership, the gifts of God that are on the inside of a man are stirred up. Why do you need the gift to be stirred up? Because everything that you need to be joyful, to be replenished, is already on the inside of you. The faithfulness of God will not allow for you to be denied. He says, out of your belly shall flow the rivers of living waters. So the laying on of hands is for the stirring up of the gift so that you can be joyful once again, even in the midst of the same situation. So that you can have the peace and the patience to persevere until change comes. Change is coming, but it's only coming to those who wait. If you are not present where God expects you to be and change comes, then you'd have to get back in line. And God forbid that you miss out on what is coming in this season. And so I want to encourage you folks, beyond coming in here and pressing into the presence of God, you also need to know how to operate as somebody whose entire existence on its own is an outpost of heaven. You are an embassy of heaven, not just an ambassador. You see, to be an ambassador is to think about yourself as an individual that gets supported. But to think of yourself as an embassy means you are a microcosm of that institution that is called the kingdom of God, which means everything that the kingdom of God has, including fences and walls for security, you also have. What the kingdom of heaven has is an unlimited number of angels that are running errands, that are making it happen. Your life also has angels assigned to you. You are an office, you're an institution, you are a mini kingdom of God. And until you begin to see yourself that way, there is no way you can intimidate the devil out of your territory. Because people don't just take territories, armies take territories. And so if you are saying, you know what, I can use that replenishing today because I have been thinking more than I have been praying. I have been concerned more than I have been joyful. And I want to see that turned around. I want to pray for you today. If you happen to be watching this online, you can tap into this grace as well, because the word of God is eternal. It is not confined by space or time, but only accessible by faith. If you would release faith in your heart and confidence in God, that these words that are coming forth are coming with healing, with strength, and with empowerment, it is yours. But you have to be able to see it by faith and by believing in God. So I would encourage you to come forward, for those of you that are here, and we're going to break bread together. Come with your bread while you're coming, because we will all break bread together. And as we break bread together today, I want you to also, in addition to that 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12, that we have just read, I want us to quickly look at Colossians chapter 1, verse 7. We may have read this a couple of days ago. Colossians chapter 1, verse 7, what does it say? It says, as you have learned from, 1:17, yes. And it says, and he is before all things, and in him all things consist, right? The Bible says he is before all things, and in him all things consist. And what does that mean? What that means is Jesus that you have on your inside came before that job opportunity. And all things are already in him. So we are never waiting for heaven to manufacture the blessing that we need. We already have it. We need to start to change our minds. We are being called to repent. What is repentance? Repentance is to have a change of mind. And so we need to start to change our minds. We are nobody's slave. We are God's children. You understand what I mean? So we're not working for free. There is a reward. And heaven's reward system comes with a multiplier For those of you that came late, Alan was explaining a vision that he saw. He was taken in the spirit and he saw heaven's value system, wherein the little that God is asking you to do is literally just a loving father's excuse to bless you with plenty. You understand what I mean? He has already done everything. He's not looking for you to build anything. He says, I will build. He's asking you to do that so that he can say to the forces that govern life, look at my children, they're delivering. And you see what I mean? Because he says in his word that he will give to you the earth, everything that is, as your inheritance. So he wants to give you everything. And so whatever he's asking you to do is literally like God is literally just looking for you to do something so that he can say, you know what? Yeah, you can take that. You can have that. And so I want you to begin to think and see yourself in that light. Anybody ready to start to live a peaceful life? Let me tell you something. I'm going to tell you this one more thing, and I'm going to start praying for people. I believe the Holy Spirit would have me share this with you. I know he would have me share this with you. You see, today's message, when the Lord showed it to me, what I saw before the message was trouble in the world. And I remember the words of Jesus. Jesus says, in the world, you have tribulations and trials. He said, but in me, you have peace. Now, this is where it gets interesting. Jesus says, I am coming into the world. So basically, instead of me trying to go into that world and facing it by myself and going to take the tribulations head on, I will go to him wherein I am cushioned in his peace and let him ride all that wave. So that means every day before I step out, I make sure that I am in him. I check to make sure that I am still in him, because sometimes when we sleep, the Bible says when men slept, the enemy came and he sowed tears. There are times when you go to sleep and you have dreams that you're not even aware of, and that is the reason why you get up and you feel this sense of urgency to go and start doing things. It's a temptation of the devil. The devil wants to get you out without you checking to see if you're still in him. Don't get out until you know that you got in. Get into him and be at peace. And then, eventually, when all these things are said and done, and we get to assemble with the saints and we're comparing notes, people will tell us things that happened on the earth. I'll be like, that happened? Oh, well, I didn't know. I read it in prophecy, but that, when it happened, I didn't know. Because the Bible says that it will not come near you. Do you know how much convincing it would have taken to tell anyone of those people who were the children of Israel of the kind of weeping that happened in the houses of the Egyptians who lost their firstborn children? No, because while those ones were weeping, it was the greatest day of joy for these ones. Oh yeah, what, Alan, what did I tell you before service started? I said it's going down, but we are going up. But this is what's going to make the difference. What's going to make the difference is where you're at. Are you in him or are you in the world? Gather your thoughts from the world. Remove your confidence from the world. Put your focus on him and not the world. And before you know what's going on, you're going to start walking upon your high places, even in the midst of the storm. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, thank you. Because before all things, you have been. And in you consist of all things. So as we eat of your body today and drink of your blood, let us drink unto the reality of your love for us. Let us eat unto the full consciousness of who we are in you and where we are standing in this very moment. Because this is holy ground. We are standing on holy ground. And so, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for your body and for your blood. I just heard this very quickly because I'm not going to be praying for individuals. I'm just going to lay my hands on you. But this is the prayer of over the house, Genesis chapter 7, verse 1. We're just going to declare this, and then I'm going to lay hands on you. So once I lay my hands on you, just make it back to your seat and start to digest what you have just received. The Bible says, and the Lord said to Noah, come into the ark. Let me read that again. What is the meaning of Noah? Noah means rest. But the man was troubled. He was about to go down. The heavens were being torn open. And the only time that heaven is going to be torn open again is when Jesus comes. He will rend open the firmaments. And so whenever the heavens are about to be torn open, it is disaster for the world, but it is rest for you if you would come into the ark. And so I say over you, everybody that is standing here today, as the Lord has given me access, authority, and permission in his love for my deep to call to your deep in righteousness, come into the ark. Come into the ark. Let your consciousness come into the ark. Let your subconscious thoughts come into the ark. Let your spirit find rest in the ark. Where is rest? Rest is in the ark. Rest is no longer out there running the streets. Nowhere is in the ark. I pray for you today supernaturally. Let me tell you something. I know deliverances are taking place in here today. The stronghold of fear is being broken. The stronghold of self-confidence is being broken. The stronghold of unhealthy reliance on the system of the world is being broken. You are being responsive this moment by grace to the commandment of God to come into the ark. Every single one of us, we are coming supernaturally into the ark. God brought you here because you are his beloved. Just think about how many people out there could be in here who are not, but you are. So don't stay at the door. Come into the ark. You may eat of the Lord's body and drink of his blood. And once you have done so, come forward and let me lay my hands on you for the stirring up of what is already inside of you by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Eat of his body, drink of his blood in remembrance of him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to put my hands on your heart just right here. Thank you, Jesus. Father, thank you. So let me tell you the reason why. There are things that you have believed, that you have stirred up, but they have not come out. You have stirred up a lot. A lot has been stirred up. You need to speak them forth for them to become reality in the mighty name of Jesus. And so that impediment is gone. It just left you. So now speak unto life and wholeness in the mighty name of Jesus. Okay, I repent. I think I'm still going to pray for people. Father, in Jesus' name. The Lord wants to give you a broader perspective. So stand back to back. You look west, you look east. Kadu pomuns enge, obums menge. I bamuns menge. Rop mumuns menge. Kabe kabe, is mumun menge. She bomuns menge. Fam pram skobodoli alabush sigiaba. Lebro dum la lis rop tala kush te bladara. He retis ye kukra blob sklu rub lob rub shala rub lob rub rub lob rub lob rub do 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 shala liala rotale mondo skrada leboste. You are bringing in the harvest and you're separating the chaff from the wheat in this season. In the mighty name of Jesus. Arakale iki ala gomsa. Herebolo kodoshtiki si ala barababa baba. It's funny that he fell because the Lord told me they will go different from how they came. You know how they came together. Now you can go in the mighty name of Jesus. One day before Jesus comes, he will get up too. Praise the Lord. You're next. Hallelujah. Koko 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 koro 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 koro. Also, if I laid my hands on you and you know in your heart there is more, you can come back. You see, there is a warning that has already gone forth to help you avoid the distraction of the enemy. That word of the Lord came through this man, but is in the mouth of this one. So if he hasn't given you already, seek him afterwards. There is a word for you. In the name of Jesus, come into the ark. Yeah, be at peace and stay at peace. So all that agitation, you will not hear the drum of the enemy calling you to come to the window. You have no business. You need to be in the ark in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. God is good. Rakwa kakaka. Have I prayed for you? Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. Serata leke 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 si. Leke 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 si. Leke 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 si. He leke 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 si. Every hole in the ark that you're in that could take in water, they are plugged right now by the asphalt of heaven. you will be above and not beneath. No matter what happens, you will be above and not beneath in the mighty name of Jesus. Now see it. Let your eyes be open to see it. In Jesus' name, amen. Where's Olivia? Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, rakwa kwa 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 rakwa kwa si kwa kwa has kwa kwa shikia kwa kwa sige. See, when you heard the voice of the Lord to come into the ark, you knew that you had delayed. You knew that you had waited for longer than you should. But because you came anyway, the Lord is granting you speed into his rest. Yakum sakum. You could have come walking, but you came swimming. But you will still get into your rest. Every detour is redeemed. You see, let me say this again. Every detour. Your mind goes there, but lately you have been resilient. And the Lord graces you today with honor. You see, when you think about the fact that, what could have happened? What would have been? What would it have been like if I had continued this or if I never stopped doing that? The Lord is saying, no, every detour is redeemed. You are where you're at now by the grace of God, nothing missing, nothing broken. Because the years that the locust and the cankerworm have eaten, the Lord has chosen to restore in his mercy and in his love. You have the Holy Spirit, not the spirit of the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Laura, come. Father, in Jesus' name, I want, what's his name, Antoine, to stand in line and be immediately in line. And I'm going to just tell you very quickly, I won't even forget. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I will do this just because I want you to see what God is saying. I will just lift up your face right here. The Lord says, look up. I am the author and the finisher of your faith. Don't just commit it into my hands to start it. I will finish it. Be confident that I will finish it. In the mighty name of Jesus. No one that you know is too lost. You can still pray for them. Sometimes you feel like it is what it is, but the Lord is saying, still mention their name. To your credit. I'm giving you inside information now. To your credit. Still mention their name. You're doing it out of love because that is already settled. So this is not because, oh, if I mention their name, then I'm going to get a reward. No, you're doing it out of love. But I am saying, don't be tired of mentioning their name before the Father. It will be to your credit regardless of the choices that they have made and what they do with the grace that you're sending their way. But mention their name one by one. One different from the other. Mention their name before the Lord in the mighty name of Jesus to their hope and to your credit in Jesus' name. So I see you standing in the back of a pickup. You have the face of a man but the body of a child and you're so eager. You almost can't wait for that pickup to stop so that you can jump out. You see, you will not be disappointed. The Bible says the expectation of the righteous will not be disappointed. So surely there is a hereafter. And so I want you to stay confident in God. Stay confident, stay excited. No matter what is happening on the pickup, stay excited. Jesus says the kingdom belongs to those who will receive it as little children. That childlike excitement, continue to fan that flame, maintain that flame. You know how it works? On some days in your adult mind, it doesn't make sense. Like, man, I need to pull myself back. Maybe I'm getting ahead of myself. No. Do your adult work when you're with adult people. But when you're in the presence of your Heavenly Father, maintain that excitement of a little child. It is a secret that of what will bring you to your plenty. I see bags just laid up. And that's where that pickup truck is going. Stay excited. Stay expectant. In the mighty name of Jesus. Papa. Come, I want everybody to stretch forth our hands toward this man and just begin to declare that Jehovah Rapha is the Lord. Jehovah Rapha is the Lord. He is the Lord that heals you. Gregory McLean, be healed in the mighty name of Jesus. Now. Be made whole. It is yours today. Seize it. Lay hold of it today. it is yours. Because everything that you need is in here. It's in the water. Lay hold of it in the mighty name of Jesus. As you go from here, you go from here a new man. Old things have passed away, behold, all things are new. For you, it is new health, new vitality in the mighty name of Jesus. And we also together say, so shall it be in the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. God is good. Alrighty, awesome. Chris and Kayla, Father, with the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. I just heard the word freely have you received, therefore freely give. So just learn how to be fluid with the things of God, with the things that come. Just be fluid. Freely have you received, freely give. Be at peace in the mighty name of Jesus. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding, let it be upon you. Come into the ark in Jesus' name. Amen. And when you get home, grab a hold of your children and physically take a step forward with them, and they will be at peace with you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And you see, I know that the spiritual blessings are not limited to instances. When I saw that, I saw Alexis in the distance looking. And I was told she can have it too. So Alexis, in the mighty name of Jesus, you will come into the ark and your children will be at peace also. In the name of Jesus. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you. The challenge, you need to take up the challenge of interceding for people. As I was praying, somebody says, I want to see like that. The word of the Lord to you is you need to be able to pray like that. You need to be able to pray for people. Pray for people. Pray for people to the point wherein you will pray for them and without even knowing that you have prayed for them. You understand what I mean? There are times wherein people will call me and they will be talking to me about stuff. And then I will realize that, wait a minute, I just prayed about that. And I wasn't even consciously praying about it, but just because. Now, let me say this very quickly. You see, what we do is collective. Who we are is unique. We all preach the gospel. We're all meant to do good things, good works. Everything we do is collective as kingdom agents. But who we are is unique. Who you are determines what you receive. So let me explain this. The Bible says the one who is a helper of the poor will inherit the riches of the wicked. Every one of us is meant to help the poor, but some people, that is who they are. Naturally, they always just want to help the poor. The Bible says that such people, their prosperity is not by the work of their hands. In fact, there is such a person here today. You've always desired to help people, but the work that you're doing doesn't seem to have ever provided enough for you to be able to do it as much. I want to pray for you today. I see you raising your hand. Let me pray for you. You see, no matter how hard you try, your prosperity is not in the work of your hands. Your prosperity is that one day you will receive an inheritance. The Bible says in Proverbs 28 that the one who gains prosperity by usury and oppression is only laying it up for the helper of the poor. You are a helper of the people who are poor and needy. And God is opening the doors for that which has been taken from the oppressor to be brought to you. They will bring to you something. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, let it happen. And it will happen. See, in the fullness of time, the Lord says to say it, in the fullness of time, by marriage, it will come. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Re 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 sikere bere dadi dadi geta baba brada shosho dolo dori geta ba. You see, don't worry. Just keep being who you are. True to the Lord and to yourself and your heart in your commitment to seeing the poor break from poverty. And that inheritance will come to you. And you will be a disburser of blessings in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you. It is raining, and you don't need to find shelter because there is a shield upon you. So just stay where you're at and be at peace. You will not be left hanging. You will not be left cold. Even without running anywhere. You see, to take shelter sometimes is to find self-preservation. The Lord is saying that you feel exposed. And you know the rain is coming. And you want to do something, and the Lord says, no, stay. I've already protected you. I've already put a coating on you that will not allow for you to be wet, even in the midst of it. Others will, this is something that could mess other people up, but no. It's not going to come near you. You have the divine seal of the Lord upon you in the mighty name of Jesus. Be at peace in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Sister Barbara, continue to profess. I got an update from the last time you were here that you started professing. Continue to profess, and you will see the salvation of the Lord. I heard that you will see the salvation of your God. And you know what that means? You have been calling his name. Keep calling his name in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for this woman. It is breakthrough season for you in life, in family life. It is breakthrough season for you. Let me tell you something. Look at me. The Lord will give them a new tongue. They will no longer speak as they used to. You understand what I mean? It has been a concern. It has been brought before the Lord, and the call from the altar has been issued. The Lord is changing their tongue. They will begin to speak as children of righteousness. They will begin to speak as those who are confident in God. They will speak of the hunger and the thirst for the righteousness of the kingdom. In the mighty name of Jesus, these same ears will hear peace. You will hear peace in the name of Jesus. God bless you. Amen. Praise the Lord. God is good. Alrighty. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. You mind if I pray for Mama first? Yeah, please come forth. Alrighty. So today when I was preaching and talking about the fact that sometimes we're here, but our minds keep checking out and going to places. I saw you trying to pull your mind back from places where your mind's been. You see what I mean? Every one of those things, the Lord was watching you. You have a covenant with the stones of the field, and the beast of the field will be at peace with you. You see, because of the fact that you have a covenant with the stone of the field, the beast cannot trouble you because it's the same covenant. Remember David and Goliath. In Genesis, the Bible says you have a covenant with the stones of the field. The beast of the field will be at peace with you. When David saw a beast of a man threatening the armies of God, he didn't go for the beast, he went for the stones, because he knows that he has a covenant with those stones. And because of that covenant, the beast had to be laid to rest. You understand what I mean? This is the season for every troubling thought to be laid to rest because of the stones of the field. Yebum sarabaka mamanda yalaba. Thank you for not having turned those stones into bread when you could have. Now, they will be the symbol of the covenant that lays the beast to rest in your life, in Jesus' name. Don't worry. You can write those things down that your mind was going to, because the Lord's taking care of them, and you will testify in Jesus' name. Amen. And it includes healing for your body. It includes healing. I see a side of you completely being fitted out with new tissue. You see, something new from heaven was brought to strengthen you, to mend you in the mighty name of Jesus. You're mended from your side, you're mended in the mighty name of Jesus. From your side, even this side, you're mended in the name of Jesus. I want you to put forth your hand this way. You see this side? Right here, you are mended. So I want you to take your hand and put it on your side and say that I am mended, and just take it down that way. Do this again. Watch my hand. Say, I am mended. Father, thank you, because it's been applied and it will do that which you have sent it. The healing of the nations begins with her. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, Lord, in Jesus' name, we thank you. Thank you, Father, because darkness cannot comprehend light. You are of the light. No darkness will overshadow you, not in your thoughts, not while you pray, not while you seek counsel. Now, I hear, not while you seek counsel. While you seek counsel, the Lord will be your counselor. You see, sometimes when you wish, oh man, I wish I had someone to make this decision with, the Lord says, stop wishing. I'm here. And I'm your companion. No more darkness, only light. And that is where your rest is. Be at rest in Jesus' name. Come into the ark and run into the ark. Nathan King, that's for you. Run into the ark. Literally, run if you can into the ark. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Ma'am, let me just quickly pray for this man. If you would stand in here, can you please go back and then run again? Because what I see is that you need to press into the speed that God has for you in this season. No, that's walking fast. Praise the Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, they shall run and they shall not be weary. By obedience and by being humble before the Lord, you have just eased your way into the righteousness of plenty. Lord, in Jesus' name, the Lord says to say to you that he has made it easy. In the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, wow. Interestingly, what I heard was, let me look up. When the Lord says he has made it easy, you looked up and you were like, wow, I didn't even know it was hard until I saw easy. So there are certain things that you just got accustomed to. You had gotten accustomed to certain kinds of rejections, certain kinds of treatments, and you've learned to live with it. But the Lord says, I've made it easy. And that was when you realized that, oh, now this is easy, not that. You see, a realization is coming, and you will recognize that it doesn't have to be as hard, as tough. It is easy. Even with others, it is going to be easy. In the mighty name of Jesus, God bless you. In Jesus' name, praise the Lord. God is good, man, and thank you for waiting. Lord, in Jesus' name, I thank you. I celebrate you once again, for this is your season of direction. You will see the finger of the Lord in this season, saying to you, this is the way. Whether you turn to the left or to the right, you will hear a voice saying to you, this is the season. I want you to open your eyes. Does anybody have the anointing here? If I don't worry about it. Lord, in Jesus' name, I thank you. Because the anointing is here, you will see. In the name of Jesus, open your eyes and see the finger of God. See where he is leading you. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. And the Lord says, he has heard me. I pray for you that in the mighty name of Jesus, you would also hear the voice of God in your heart. Your eyes will see the direction and the voice will be there as a testimony, a witness and a testimony. Do not worry, ma'am. It is already taken care of. The Lord has given you such an awesome report. You have a goodly report. In Jesus' name, praise the Lord. God is good. Alrighty, Jordan. Father, in Jesus' name, I want you to stand here. So for you to be where you need to be another person. Okay? And most of what you have read in Scripture would say, and this person became another man. And Saul became another man. You see, there is a transformation that is coming wherein even you may not recognize yourself until others begin to call you for who you have become. Saul was still doing his father's business. He didn't even know until others came and said, they said, wait a minute, has he now also become one of the sons of the prophets? That was how different he had become from who he was. He needed a seer, and in a moment he became a prophet. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, be made new. In the name of Jesus, be made new. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah, be made new. In the name of Jesus, be made new. In the name of Jesus, and for the ones who are connected to your new season that you may have overlooked, the Lord is granting you now express favor to show them kindness. Not only will you notice them, but you will show them kindness. That holds the key. It holds the key because they have things in their hands with which you are going to prophesy in the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord has a new office for you, an office of righteousness, wherein your thoughts would just be in line with his will, your actions. It's a new office of righteousness in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you. In the name of Jesus, woman of God, be encouraged. This season, the Lord is bringing both of you up, you and your husband. The Lord is using you to raise him up in revelation, to raise him up in insight into the things of God. You see, because now you have become a window through which he will also see that which the Lord has on the way. In the mighty name of Jesus. No explaining needed, just great agreements. In the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. God is good. Alrighty. God is good. Is that everybody? Oh, Charles, God is good. So the season has already begun, but you're still waiting for it. Okay? Your new season has already begun, but you're still waiting for it. It doesn't begin when man says it begins. It doesn't begin when the paperwork says it begins. It begins when the Lord says it has begun. So right now, receive a new posture. Receive a heart of instruction that would allow for you to begin to parade and comport yourself in the new, in the mighty name of Jesus. So you see that new person that, oh, I'm going to be this, I'm going to be that. You are already who God says you are. Amen. Now just begin to act it, begin to talk it, begin to think it more consciously in the name of Jesus. Come into the ark in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. God is good. Oh, the masons. Praise the Lord. The builders. God. So let me give you an insight into something that I've been pressing in for your sake. Okay, you don't know this, but I believe it's time for me to tell you. I've been pressing in for the Lord to give you a business. I've been pressing in and pressing in and pressing in. Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus, give them the heart to receive that which you have presented to them. You see, I have been pressing in and pressing in, and I have seen it. And now receive it. In the name of Jesus. Let me now tell you what I saw concerning the business. You see, your wife has a desire to go and look for people to bring into the kingdom. But the business is what will bring them. You understand what I mean? You don't have to go looking for them. They will be the ones coming to you. You will be in that place minding your business. You will be busy. And the word of God and the witness of the Holy Spirit will come out of you unto the fulfillment of grace in the lives of many. In the name of Jesus. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you. Oh, yes. You see, for you, the transition will be so seamless that you would wonder. I see you standing there and saying, wow, if anyone had told me that I could do this, I'd be like, how in the world? It's not in the world. It is in the Spirit. In the name of Jesus. Let there be a multiplication of the gifts that you have tasted. Let there be a delivery of the ones that you have desired. In the mighty name of Jesus. And let your heart be confident in the dealings of the Lord with you. He is with you. He has heard you. He has answered. He has come and he has delivered by the ministry of his angels and through the hand of his anointed that which your heart has desired. Now give him thanks for it because you also have become another man in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. God is good. All righty. Okay. Awesome, possum. You see, my wife is like, oh, you pray for everybody. You didn't pray for me. Lord Jesus. So, it is your time to manage with great grace for administration. You see what I mean? You see, manage resources, manage people, manage time. It's what you are designed for, and now it's here. So, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus, the grace to apply that which has already been embedded, the grace to be caught up, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, on things of divine stewardship. This is the season for it. Oh, you will steward greatly, great things in righteousness. And here upon the earth, it shall be known that the Lord has found you faithful. In the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. God is good. Awesome. Alrighty. So don't worry. I have spoken to you in dark sayings, but I will speak to you more clearly. That's for my wife. Oh, yeah. Because I wasn't just being proverbial. I know exactly what I saw. I've just not been given to say, but I will say, and you will know. God is good. Alrighty. You might be feeling a little exhausted. It's okay. By the time you step out of here, you will begin to feel that replenishing. I know some people sneaked out already, but it's okay. Even those of you that have stayed, you have stayed because you were pressing in for more and more is yours in the mighty name of Jesus. Even the ones who have left, everyone who has come in here today in obedience, overcoming obstacles, discouragement, overcoming obstacles, resistances to be here, you have been greatly rewarded and honored by the Lord. Just give him thanks. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Let's celebrate the Lord. Let's celebrate the man of God that he sent before us. Come on. God is so good. That's right. So, y'all know I'm not going to hold this. If you need an offering envelope, come see me. You can come and grab it. And I'll put the basket over here if you need to come in and drop off there. But let's just give in faith. Let's thank God. Let's just stay in this posture of thanksgiving. Father, we thank you. We love you, O God, for how you've dealt beautifully with us on tonight, O God, how you minister to us plainly. Lord, as a body, as Communion House, Lord, we ask of thee that you pour back into the man and woman of God, Lord God, as they have ministered to us tonight, as the man of God has ministered, pour back into them, Lord. Let these offerings be sweet-smelling unto you. Let them be multiplied, O God, for the benefit of this house, O God, bringing you glory. We say that we know that you give the seed to the sower, O God, and we thank you for the opportunity. All glory and honor belong to you. And everyone said, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want everyone to have a blessed night. Have a blessed night. Be safe on the road. We will see y'all Saturday.